Suchness, the way of the no mind. The word suchness is of immense importance in Buddha's approach towards reality. The word is as important in Buddhism as God in other religions. The Buddhist word for suchness is tathata. It means seeing things are such without taking any attitude. Do not make any opinion and do not judge or condemn. The Buddhist meditation consists of suchness. The method is very practical and very deep. Buddha told his disciples, just watch things as they are, without interfering, without judging or anything. For example, you have a headache. The moment you take note of it, immediately the opinion enters that it is not good. Why do I have headache? What should I do not to have the headache? You are immediately worried. You have taken an opinion. You are against it. You have started repressing it. You have to repress it chemically through an analgesic, or you have to repress it in consciousness, but you never look at it. You put it aside. You get involved in something else to avoid the pain. You want to be distracted in something else so you can forget it. But in both ways, you have missed the suchness. What would Buddha suggest? Buddha says, take note twice. Headache, headache. Do not feel inimical towards it, neither friendly nor antagonistic. Just take a simple note as if it has nothing to do with you. Headache, headache. And remain undisturbed, undistracted, and uninfluenced by it without any opinion. See the point. Immediately 90% of the headache is gone because headache is not a real headache. 90% arises out of the antagonistic opinion. Immediately you will see that the greater part of it is no longer there. And another thing will be noted. Sooner or later you will see that headache is disappearing in something else. Maybe you are now feeling anger. What happened? If you repress headache, you will never come to know what its real message was. Headache was there just as an indicator that you are full of anger in this moment, and the anger is creating a tension in the head. Hence there is headache. Most of the times these are the things that indicate that something or the other you have been overlooking. But you watched, you simply took note of it, headache, headache, and you remained impartial yet objective. Then the headache disappears, and the headache gives you the message that I am not a headache, instead I am anger. Now Buddha says, take note again, anger, anger. Now do not become angry with anger, otherwise again you are trapped and you have missed the suchness. If you say anger, anger, 90% of the anger will be gone immediately. This is a very practical method that Buddha told his monks to follow. And then 10% that will be left will release its message. You may come to see that it is not anger. The process of suchness continues. You may come to see that it is not anger. Instead, it is ego. Again, take note. Ego, ego, and so on and so forth. One thing is connected with another. And the deeper you move, you come closer to the original cause. As such, you do not know the cause of your headache. Then when you take note of it, you realize that it is anger. So when you take note of anger, you realize it is not anger really that is bothering you. Instead, it is your ego. You are going deeper and deeper. And once you have come to the original cause, the chain is broken. There is nothing beyond it. A moment will come when you will take note of the last link in the chain and then nothingness. Then you are released from the whole chain and there will arise great purity, great silence, and that silence that remains after all this is known as suchness. This has to be practiced continuously. Sometimes it may happen that you forget and you have made an opinion unconsciously or mechanically. Then Buddha says, remember again, opinion, opinion. Now do not get distracted by it that you have made an opinion. Do not get depressed that you have missed. Just take note, opinion, opinion. As suddenly you will see, 90% of the opinion is gone, 10% remains, and that releases its message to you. What is the message? The message is that there is some inhibition, some taboo. Out of that taboo, the opinion has arisen. So finally you have come to the point. A sex desire comes in the mind and immediately you say, this is bad. This is opinion. Why is it bad? Because you have been taught it is bad. It is a taboo for you. Take note. Again, taboo, taboo, and go on. You are continuing the process that you said that you have a headache. You are going deeper into it. You realize that so many things are unfolding itself. Sometimes it will also happen that not only judged, you have made an opinion. Not only made an opinion, you have become depressed that you have missed. Then again take note, depression, and this way you go on. Whenever you become conscious at whatsoever point, from there take note. Just a simple note and leave the whole thing. As soon as you will see the entangled mind is no longer as entangled as it has always been, things start disappearing and there will be moments of suchness, tathata, when you will be simply there and the existence is there and there is no opinion between you and the existence. All is undisturbed and unpolluted by thoughts. Existence is, but mind has disappeared. That state of no mind, when there is no opinion, there is nothing all that is concerned with the mind, that state is called suchness. Buddha says, a Tathagat is synonymous with suchness. This is why Buddha's another name is Tathagat. Thus came, thus gone. No opinion, nothing. Synonymous, and not that he has the quality of suchness. He is embodiment of suchness instead. And Buddha says that Tathagat speaks in accordance with the reality. He cannot do otherwise. It is not that he chooses to speak in accordance with reality. There is no choice for him. Whatsoever is real is spoken through him. It is not that he chooses, this is real and I should speak this, and that is unreal and I will not speak that. If that choice has arisen, you are not a Buddha yet. A Tathagat speaks out of choicelessness. So it is not that Tathagat speaks truth. In fact, it should be said in this way that whatsoever is spoken by Tathagat is true. It's not that Buddha is speaking truth. Instead, whatsoever he speaks is truth. He speaks in accordance with the reality. In fact, reality speaks through him. He is just a medium, a hollow. The reality sings its song through him. He has no song of his own. All his opinions have disappeared and he himself has disappeared. He is pure, empty space. Truth can pass through him into the world. Truth indeed can descend through him into the world and reach you if you are open. He speaks the truth, he speaks of what is, and this is called Yatha Bhutam, as it is. Whatsoever is the case, he speaks. He has no mind about it, he never interferes, he does not drop a thing, he does not add a thing. He is a mirror. Whatsoever comes in front of the mirror reflects. This reflectiveness of a Buddha is suchness. A Tathagata Subhuti is synonymous with true suchness. And why does he say true suchness? Is there some untrue suchness as well? Yes, you can practice. You can practice, you can cultivate a certain quality called suchness, but that will not be true. The true suchness has not to be cultivated. You do not cultivate mannerism when something happens within. Out of that, a mannerism is born, a way of life is born. That is the way of suchness. It is not cultivated. Instead, it becomes natural and spontaneous for you. For example, what do I mean when I say you can cultivate? You can decide I will only speak the truth, whatsoever the consequence. Even if I have to lose my life, I will speak the truth. And you speak the truth. This is not true suchness. It is your decision. The untruth arises in you. You go on pushing down the untruth. You say, I have decided that even if my life is at stake, I am going to be true. It is an effort. Truth has become your prestige. Deep down you are longing to be a martyr. Entire world know that you are a truthful man, that you are ready to sacrifice your life for it. You are a great man, a sage. And you sacrifice your life, but it is not true suchness. True suchness knows nothing of choice. You are simply an instrument of reality. You do not come in. You do not stand in between. You simply have withdrawn yourself. The mirror does not decide. This man who is standing in front of me is ugly. Certainly, I am going to show him his real face. Whatsoever be the consequence, mirror does not say anything like this. Even if he throws a stone at me because he is ugly, he may get angry at me. That does not matter. I am going to show him his real face. If a mirror thinks that way, then mirror is no longer a mirror. Mind is coming. This is the simple point. If mirror thinks that way, then mirror is no longer a mirror. Mind has come in. It is not mirroring. Instead, it is the decision of the mirror. The purity is lost. But a mirror is simply there. It has no mind. So is Buddha. That is why Buddha uses the word true suchness. He is simply a mirror. Whatsoever comes in front of it, reveals a true face, trueness. This is Buddhist meditation of taking note of it. Try it and play with it. I cannot say practice it. I can only say play with it, sitting, walking, sometimes remember it. And when you remember, just play with it. And you will be surprised that Buddha has given to the world one of the greatest techniques to penetrate into your innermost core. You will be surprised. Psychoanalysis does not go that deep. It also depends on something like this free association of thoughts. But it remains superficial because the other's presence is a hindrance. The psychoanalyst is sitting there, even if he is sitting behind a screen, but you know he is there. That very knowledge that somebody is there hinders. You cannot be a real mirror because the presence of the other cannot allow you to open yourself totally. You can open totally only to your own self, not to others. Buddha's method is far more deep going because it is not to be told to anyone else. You have just to take note of it inside. It is subjective and yet objective. The phenomena has to happen in your subjectivity, but you have to remain objective about it. Just take note and go on taking note as if it is none of your business, as if it is not happening to you, as if you have been appointed to do some job. Stand on this corner of the road and just take note of whatsoever passes by. A woman, a man, a dog, car, whatsoever passes, it matters not what it is. You have nothing to do. You are not involved. You are absolutely aloof and distant. It can take you from one thing to another. And then one moment comes when you have reached to the very cause of a certain chain, to the very end. And there are many chains in your being. Thousands of threads have gone intertwined into one another. You have become a mess. You will have to follow each thread slowly. And ultimately you have to come to the end of every thread. Once the end is reached, then chain disappears from your being. You are less burdened. Slowly and slowly, one day it happens. All threads have disappeared. Because you have looked into all causes that were causing them, they were effects, and you were looking into the effects only. One day when all the causes have been looked into, you have observed everything, all the games of the mind that it goes on playing with you, all the tricks and cunningness of it, all the deceptions and mischiefs too, the whole mind disappears as if it has never been there. There is a famous sutra Buddha had said about mind, about life, about existence. The sutra is one of the golden ones. Buddha says, think about the mind as a star, a fault of vision, as a lamp, the moksha, dew drops, or a bubble, a dream, a lightning flash, or a cloud. So should one view what is conditioned. Mind is a conditioned phenomenon. It is the effect of some cause. You cannot destroy the effect directly. You will have to go to the very cause. You cannot destroy a tree by cutting its branches and leaves and foliage. You will have to go to its roots. The roots are the hidden cause and they are hidden underneath. So you are the roots in you. These things you have to understand. Buddha says, think of your mind as stars. Why? Stars exist only in darkness. They are visible only in darkness. When morning comes and the sun rises, all stars disappear. When the light descends in your being, the mind disappears. There is no mind, there is no thought, there is nothing. So is your mind. It exists only in unconsciousness. When the sun of consciousness rises, it disappears, just like stars. Never fight with the stars. You will not be able to destroy them. They are millions. Just become more and more aware. They will disappear on their own accord. This is a fault of vision. Your eye is ill. It has some fault. Then you see things which are not there. For example, you may be seeing double or you may be seeing patterns because your eyes is not as it should be. If your liver is not good, your eyes will start seeing things which are not there. A weak liver, the eyes will see patterns in the air, bubbles, designs, and they are not really there. Instead, they are caused by your eye itself. You cannot fight with them. You cannot destroy them because they do not exist. All that is needed is that you will have to go to a physician. Your eyes need treatment. Your eyes need to be cured. And Buddha used to say, I am not a philosopher. I am a physician. I do not give you a doctrine. I do not give you a theory. I simply give you a medicine. I do not talk about what light is. I only help you to open your eyes so that you can see for yourself. The blind man cannot be helped by definitions of light and color and rainbows. The only help possible is that his eyes have to be brought back. You cannot explain to a deaf person what music is. Only when he can hear, he will know. The experience is the only explanation. Experience is the only explanation. Third, Buddha says, think of man as a lamp. Why as a lamp? Lamp burns only while oil in it lasts. Once the oil is finished, the flame is gone. So is the mind. And the oil is the desire. If there are desires in the mind will remain alive. The lamp will remain lit. Do not fight with the flame. Just do not go on pouring fuel on it. Desire is the fuel for the mind. Desire means that which is, you are not satisfied with it. You want something else. You are not living in suchness. That is what desire means. Desire means you want things to be other than what they are. You do not want them the way they are. You want to have your own ideas. You have your private dreams to impose upon reality. You are not contented with the reality as such. Instead, you want to change it according to your own heart's desire. Then mind will remain. Mind exists because you are not connected with reality. There is a discontinuity between you and reality, and mind is the outcome of it. Down the ages, people have been asking how to stop the thoughts. They want to stop thoughts directly, but thoughts cannot be stopped directly. Thoughts exist because desires exist. Unless you understand desire and drop them, you will not be able to drop thoughts. Thoughts are the byproduct of the mind, and thoughts are the content of the mind. First, the desire comes in. You see a beautiful car passing by, and desire arises. And Buddha will say, car, car, and be finished. If a desire has arisen in you, say again, desire, desire, and be finished. But you have seen a beautiful car and a dream, and a desire takes possession of you, and you are lost in the wilderness. So now many thoughts will arise. You want to know, how can I manage to purchase this car? Should I sell my house? Should I go to the bank? Should I earn more money? Legal or illegal, what should I do? This car has to be possessed. Now, how can you stop the thoughts? But if you do not drop the desire, how can you stop thinking? Thinking comes as a help. You want to be the prime minister. The mind starts spinning and weaving. The mind says, now I have to look into things, how it should be managed. Now there are 1001 problems to be solved. Only then can your desire be fulfilled. Thinking is a device of desire to fulfill itself. You cannot stop thinking directly. Buddha says desire is like oil in the lamp. If the oil is no more, the flame will disappear on its own. Think of mind as a lamp. Think of mind as a mock show, a magic show. Nothing is substantial there. It is a kind of a hypnotic state. The hypnotist has hypnotized you and he says, look at the animal, the camel is coming. And there arises a form of a camel in your mind. And you start looking at the camel. And the camel exists there for you. Everybody is laughing because nobody is seeing the camel, but you are seeing it. This is what happens to you on a day-to-day basis. Your mind is a magic box. This is what Buddha has said again and again. It goes on creating phantoms and imaginations, which have no substance in them. But if you want to believe in them, they will become real for you. And that will be the cause of your misery and agony and pain. Your mind is a great mock show. In fact, the English word magic comes from the Indian word Maya. Maya means illusion that does not exist but appears to you to exist. Illusions can be created and you all create in you illusions. You see a woman, but you never see Yathabhutam as she is. That is why there is so much frustration afterwards. You start seeing things which are not there, instead that are only projections of your mind. All your problems in your life relating to your job, relating to your husband, relating to your wife, relating to anything are all projections of your mind. You project beauty, you project a thousand and one things on that poor woman. When you come closer, when you are able to live with the woman, those phantoms will start wearing out. Those imaginations cannot persist against reality for long. The woman's reality will assert itself. The man's reality will assert itself. And then you will feel cheated and you will think that he or she has cheated you. But this is all your creation. She herself is feeling cheated by you because she has also projected something on you. She was thinking you are a hero, an Alexander or something, a great man. And now you are just a mouse and nothing else. And she was thinking you to be a mountain, but you are not even a molehill. She feels cheated. You both feel cheated. You both feel frustrated. I have heard a woman walked into the missing persons bureau for the complaint. My husband disappeared last night, she reported. We will do our best to find him. The officer assured her and asked, kindly give us a description of the man. Well, the woman waited a little and then said, he is about 5 feet 6 inches tall, wears fancy glasses, he has a beautiful hairstyle, always dressed elegantly with pleasant demeanor, and has a high-pitched voice. And then she stopped and thought for a moment and said, oh, just forget to add more description. She gave a totally different description of the missing man. Nearby woman, who knew the family very well, heard everything. So she told the woman who was making the complaint, but that description is not of your husband. So the woman replied, if they are searching for the missing man, then why not look for someone better than the man that I know and already have? This is the situation of each one of you. If you see the reality, that is how it is, you will say, oh, forget the whole thing. But you do not see. You go on projecting things. That is how we go on living. Reality is never frustrating. Reality is always fulfilling. Frustrations come because we impose our illusions on reality. Buddha says it is a mock show. Be aware of your mind. It is a magician. It shows you things which are not there and which have never been there. It deludes you. It creates an unreal world around you, and then you live in that unreal world full of misery and agony. This world of trees and birds and animals and mountains is not real, but the world that your mind creates is unreal. When you hear people like Buddha talking about the unreality of the world, Never misunderstand them. They do not mean that the trees are unreal. Also, they do not mean that people are unreal. They mean that whatsoever you have been thinking about reality is unreal. Indeed, your mind is unreal. Once mind is dropped, all is real. Then you live in suchness. Then you become Tathata. Then you are suchness. I have heard. The professor was telling a morning class, I have found that the best way to start the day is to exercise for 5 minutes. Take a deep breath of fresh air and then finish with a cold shower. Then I feel rosy all over. A sleepy voice from the back of the classroom responded, tell us more about rosy. The mind is ready to jump upon anything to project. Be very careful with mind. That is what meditation is all about, being careful and not being deceived by the mind.